Learning from Croaky here at the National Nursing Forum in Hobart, and I'm speaking here with Mel Robinson from CATSINaM. Mel, would you be able to introduce yourself professionally and culturally?
Sure, thank you, Mari. My name's Mel Robinson. I have connections to the Narinyin and Gidja people of the Kimberley of Western Australia. I'm also the Chief Executive Officer of CATSINaM, the Congress of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander Nurses and Midwives. And I've just moved over from Wadjuk country in Perth to Ngunnawal country in Canberra. And I've just been sitting there since February doing work as a CEO for CATSINaM. And I got invited to the Australian College of Nursing Forum, which is where we are. And I'm just talking about needing for more nurses in policy, but also more Indigenous nurses in general and midwives across Australia. So.
And you talked quite a bit about your work in Western Australia.
Yes,
there.
Yes. So I talked a lot about what I did in the Aboriginal Health Policy Directorate and how we're sort of making transformation in terms of the numbers of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander nurses and midwives that are coming through. I'm making sure that they're getting the same opportunities as other graduates in terms of employment, but also supporting them through university as well with cadetship programs and models that sort of encourage them to continue their studies and not to drop out and not to be challenged by their own cultural obligations, you know, sorry, business, family, that sort of stuff. And also dealing with racism in the health system. So, you know, as people would know, there is racism. We've had, you know, Adam Good's story come out now, the Australian Dream movie's out. So I'd encourage people to go and watch those types of things because it is alive and well and it does impact on our people when they're going into hospitals and clinics and stuff. So our students who are studying and the CATSINaM members tell us, you know, that they see it every day in their clinical placements, in their workplace. And how do we deal with that? And how do we create a system that's culturally safe so they can, you know, feel comfortable, one, to disclose their identity and be proud of their Aboriginality, but also to be able to support the patients and families that come through. So it's not always the Aboriginal Torres Strait Islander nurse or midwife having to look after everyone. It's actually a shared load across all the clinicians that work in that service. Because at the moment, what happens is an Aboriginal or Torres Strait Islander person comes through the door, they'll see that Indigenous nurse or midwife and then straight away they'll want them to care for them because that's what feels safe for them. But it actually shouldn't be like that. It should be all clinicians are accountable and responsible for providing that same kind of service that is culturally safe. And I say to people, that's even when you first come through the door, the receptionist or the person at the front of the house needs to be really culturally safe because that defines your whole experience through that service, that one sort of encounter. And that's not difficult. That's just about being friendly, welcoming, a smile, you know, not continuing to work when someone comes in and not acknowledge their presence. It's really simple stuff, but really important, I think, Murray, yeah.
A really big thing that has come up here and, of course, comes up all over the place for Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people is that it's not just that the healthcare system is not just unsafe often for patients,
yeah,
but also for the workforce.
Yes, well, absolutely.
What should the system be doing?
I think they've got to make a genuine commitment to want to change things, and it shouldn't just be a talking about and saying we want to do. They need to show by actions, I reckon. Lots of services still don't have a RAP plan, a Reconciliation Action Plan, and that's a huge issue. You know, that's a beginning point for an organisation. Everyone needs to develop a RAP. You know, it's really important to show engagement with the community. It's really important to make sure your staff have done some form of training. Obviously, I promote cultural safety because that's what CATSINaM does, but some sort of cultural training and not only understands some of the concepts, but also understands the community that they're living and working in and knows the stories from that community as well, but also helps support their workforce. So we're seeing a lot of turnover in the bigger hospitals and that because people don't feel safe. You know, their abilities are sort of questioned. They're labelled as Aboriginal before they're labelled as a good clinician. And it's a bit of both, you know, for them. But they're also seeing things where family members are treated really poorly, you know. And I think a little bit about the Naomi Williams story and Tumut Hospital, but also Wagga as well and the other hospital she went to, you know, for them to now actually reflect since the coroner's report's come out and think about how they could have done things differently and not blaming the patient or the person, which is what happens. They blame, you know, our people for being non-compliant or not doing the right thing. In her case, she was labelled as a drug user, so then that defined all of her care, and then she never got a proper clinical assessment that she should have got, and she never got referral to a specialist. And, you know, now you have a grieving family and a grieving partner, you know, who doesn't have this woman they loved and this little baby that they should be holding and enjoying now. And I think everyone's responsible for that. But what happens with our Aboriginal and Torres Strait nurse and midwives is they carry that burden, and they try to be everything for everyone, including teaching non-Indigenous clinicians about cultural safety. And it's exhausting, and you get burnt out. And, you know, we have to sort of share that burden, I think. And they also then bring in good engagement, but then that brings more responsibility. So, and also balancing your life and your cultural obligations as well is really tricky when you're trying to be a worker. I was talking to someone the other day about, you know, having to take lots of time off for sorry business and then not having any leave left, you know, because they're doing sorry business, they're caring for family, they've got other responsibilities, and then they've got no leave for themselves when they get sick or they need a break or whatever. So the system doesn't recognise that our commitments go beyond the work, and they're actually much broader, and it doesn't do enough, I think, to support that, you know, whether it's needing flexible kind of work hours or flexible time off. You know, it's like, well, this is, you're a nurse or you're a midwife, this is your hours, this is what you do. And there's none of that sort of, unless you've got a good unit manager, there's none of that sort of support or recognition that you are carrying a big burden.
Are you seeing, in the wake of cases like Naomi Williams, are you seeing a bigger approach from mainstream services to you for cultural safety training?
Yeah, I think there's a bit more interest now, and I'm not sure. We have reached out to the hospital and to the manager there, and we've offered them cultural safety training. And I certainly am going to do a bit of work as well to engage the family, because I do want to hear what they think is needed. And I think it's really important that peaks like us take into account both sides of the story. But I think we're getting a lot of interest in the training and what can we do better. But then it's always they hide behind like lack of funding to be able to do stuff.
The implementation.
Yeah, so I try and kind of reduce the cost of the training as much as I can, but I've got to cover my own costs and things. So just trying to balance that. I think people are genuinely interested in trying to make it better, but the commitment sometimes is difficult, and it's all reliant on having one person that is, and it should be the whole service. It should be the executive, the senior leaders, like everyone needs to be involved. So the ED nurses need to know that this is driven from the top, then they engage better as well. And I don't know, I think sometimes clinicians see issues with bad experiences in the service as our problem, and it's like, it's not our problem, it's actually your problem, and it's a shared issue, and be open to understanding that and making change so it's better next time. So I don't know, I feel saddened that, you know, with this Naomi story and then we had Miss Jew, it's like these stories are still happening, and I'm not sure, I think we need a national approach to start addressing this. So I've been talking to the other peaks and saying, how can we drive this together as leaders? How can we say to federal government and states and territories, we all need to come together on this stuff? And that's why I like what WA Health has done with the WA Health Aboriginal Health and Wellbeing Framework and the workforce strategy we did, is that the leadership there said, let's do something about this. You know, the Director General was involved, the Minister, all the way down to the staff that were developing it. And we just all worked together to say, we want a system-wide approach. And I'm really proud of the office and the people that were involved, and Wendy Casey, the director there, because they stood their ground and it was tough. But we've come up with something that actually drives change across the whole system and not just little pockets, you know. So everyone's now accountable. They all have to report with the measures that are in there, and everyone owns that and takes responsibility for that. And the chief executives report to the director general. So there's no way that anyone can, you know, say, well, we didn't achieve our workforce target. Oh, well, you know, we can't find Aboriginal staff. They have to now actually be proactive and do more and be more accountable as well. So I think if I could share that at this forum, but broader, And hopefully we start driving in that direction on a national level. You know, I was really saddened when the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander Health Workforce Working Group, ATSIWG, was disbanded. And I was talking to some of the members from that last week who were on it with me, and they said, you know, nothing's happening now. You know, it's all come to a standstill. So federal government sort of dropped the ball on some of these things that are really important if you want to get a national approach and really drive change. And, you know, there's lots of evidence. If you get one of our mob into a job and they love the job, that transforms their whole life, let alone the economic and the social advantage that comes from that, you know. And I talked a little bit today about some of the enrolled nurses that I've supported who are 6, 7, 8 years down the road now and still working and still loving their jobs, but had to do a training through a college, Marmuditch, where they needed that support and guidance, but they've blossomed now, you know. But they still struggle to get jobs in mainstream because of their Aboriginality, which I find disappointing. And people will make up reasons why that is, but we all know there's an element of racism there, you know, and it's unfair. So, you know, how do we create pathways that allow our people into jobs? Because that's where they want to be, and not block them and make up excuses why they can't come and work for an organisation, you know. And that's more than a wrap plan. That's them making a commitment, writing policies and strategies, getting all their exec on board, and doing almost an affirmative action approach to employment. So like I was saying this morning, you know, having policies that say if you identify and if you've got the skills and abilities and you meet the criteria, give you the job over someone else who's not Indigenous, who may have more experience or more qualifications, because you can still do the job. You just can't compete on a competitive process. And it's unfair. So, I mean, people may or may not disagree with that approach, but I think that's the way we need to be. I sometimes think about quarantining jobs, but I don't want people going, oh, you got that job because you're Indigenous, because I think that's another challenge. You know, you should get the job because you're good at the job. Like, and the fact that you're Indigenous is a bonus to me. So I talk a lot to members about that, and, you know, most of them agree that's how they want to be seen as well. So
now you talked federal government and national approaches.
Yeah.
The federal government announced its long-term health plan earlier this month, I think.
Yeah.
It's got a big focus on Indigenous health, but what do you make of it?
Oh, look, I think this government's very interesting, and, you know, they've got their own approach to things. We've seen that with the Uluru Statement from the Heart and the lack of acceptance of that. We've seen that with the announcement of the referendum. You know, and a lot of people are saying to me, why are we having a referendum? We should just change the constitution. We don't need to ask for permission for that. But it's like they're scared of being, you know, take it where it needs to go. And same with the health announcement. You know, I think that hasn't gone far enough. I think they're trying to do things, but they're not going to where we need to go to really make change.
What's missing for our people?
I think it's just, I don't know, it's a bit like the closing the gap targets. The voice of our people isn't in the development side. So, you know, they'll get people writing it, they'll get consultants in, but they're not reflecting what we know, which is what we need to do to really make a difference. So, like, with the coalition of the peaks and this new closing the gap target stuff, or close the gap targets, we really need to drive that agenda because we know what works. And what I've seen from federal government is they're trying to drive an agenda, but they don't understand the issues that are actually happening out on the ground. You know, rural and remote issues are different to the urban issues. And I feel like they just haven't gone far enough and they haven't done enough consultation. And I worry sometimes when you absorb the whole thing into a whole big agenda that we'll lose some of that momentum. And in some ways I like having standalone kind of approaches to health for our people, and it should be determined by our people how that looks and what happens in that space. So I'm not sure. I think they're making an effort, and it's good to see they've done what they've done, but it's just, yeah, they haven't quite gone far enough for me.
Is it possible to even talk about those issues without being supportive of the Uluru Statement?
Well, that's a really good question. I think that's a part of the problem is that, you know, and there was a beautiful video that Rachel Perkins directed recently about all the opportunities we've offered government and all the kind of ways we've tried to engage over the years. You know, we've had Makaratas, you know, the Barangaroo Statement, like lots of things where we've tried to give an olive branch and say to government, we want to work with you, but this is what we need. And they turn their backs on it. And I feel like this has happened with the Uluru Statement. I mean, the Australian Medical Association endorsed it. And I'm like, if the doctors can get on board, you know, what is wrong with our government? So I think it'll be one of those things, but they're really fighting it where community drive it and all the peak bodies drive it, including the non-Indigenous ones. But these government have dug their heels in and they just will not back down on it. And I've heard Ken speak about it a few times, Ken Wyatt, you know, great having a minister for First Australians, but he even skirts around it and he won't even have a proper conversation about it, and I find that really disappointing. And I think to be genuinely engaged and to make a change, we've got to start telling the truth-telling, the history stuff. We've got to give our people a voice and we've got to have some sort of treaty process. And the Uluru is the beginning of that. And I've had a couple of trips to New Zealand and you see the value of them being recognised, having a treaty. Yes, there's issues with their treaty. Yes, they've still got health issues. But the strength that gives them as a culture and as a people is unbelievable. And if we could even just start that process, I'm not talking about a referendum, I'm talking about genuine engagement, standing up and saying we accept the Uluru Statement, we accept the intent and we want to work with you, even if we're not going to agree to a voice to parliament, it's the first step to that healing. And I feel like this country's still not being honest about the issues. And that's what I felt. I haven't seen Adam Goods's movie, but I feel like that's what he's going to talk about, is that we're not actually owning it. We're not saying the booing was racism. We're denying that it even exists. So until we start accepting and acknowledging and owning the issues, and until our government leads the way in that, I think we've got a long way to go. So
In terms of truth-telling and history,
we're
here at the Nursing National Forum.
Yes.
National Nursing Forum. And there's a lot around here about Florence Nightingale, yes, because of the Nursing Now international campaign. What are your thoughts about that?
Oh, look, Florence Nightingale. You know, I learnt about her at university in nursing school. She's always held up as the pillar of, you know, the founder of nursing. I find it a bit disappointing, given that there is some evidence that she wrote about Aboriginal people, you know, in a derogatory way. You know, she called them filthy and loathsome. I've seen presentations where, you know, it's been told about what she thought. And I feel really disappointed that they've done that. I think we've got lots of nursing leaders around the world who have done really good work and should be recognised for International Year of the Nurse and Midwife and also the Nursing Now. So I've written to our nursing leaders in Australia and I've said I won't be promoting it to the CATSINaM members until the Nightingale Foundation provides us with an apology. I'm planning to talk to the International Alliance of Indigenous Nurses and write to the Nightingale Foundation and explain our position, but we won't be supporting any campaign linked to Florence Nightingale because of her history and because of what she wrote about our people. So we're just going to take a strong stand. I find it really difficult coming to things like this because it is a big part of it, and I do find that really difficult, and I have told the leaders of the different organisations where I stand. And, you know, most of them are understanding. Some want to talk more about it, but I'm just taking a firm stand and I will not be promoting their campaign to our CATSINaM membership because I think anyone that's disrespectful to any First People probably doesn't deserve our recognition and support. And I was really saddened because I was a big admirer of Florence and what she did, and not to undermine any of the good work she did do, but it's really bad. And I know people say, oh, it was probably a sign of the times and how they looked at Indigenous people, but I'm like, it doesn't matter. It's still hurtful now. And this is all part of that truth-telling, that seeking forgiveness, that being honest about what the true history was. So I'm just taking a firm stand, and all the other peaks that I've talked to have agreed, and also, you know, the international members as well.
That's all the other Indigenous health peaks.
Yeah.
What about the nursing bodies in Australia? What do you want them to do?
Look, they feel awkward about it. They recognise how we feel, but in terms of them taking action, I think they're really torn because they are a part of this International Nursing Now campaign. They've signed up to it and it's probably a bit too late to pull it back. So they're trying to be careful about how it's promoted. They're trying to be mindful of the difficulties for our people. But, yeah, I don't know. They're sort of torn between doing what's required of them as a peak, but also making sure that we're still comfortable with it. So I'm going to something with the ANMF in Victoria, and they've started talking to me about how do we want to do this. We still have to promote nursing now, but how does CATSINaM want us to approach it? So it's good when they come and have those conversations. And I know certainly Kylie Ward in the past, the ACN CEO, has acknowledged to a group a presentation that she's comfortable as well with it. But, you know, I think they've got to take a stand. But I think it's really difficult for them because they've already signed up on this campaign, and it's the gates, you know, the horse has bolted out of the gate and now they're in the middle of it. But I think just to acknowledge that that happened, still have a campaign. I support the what Nursing Now is about. We definitely need more nurses in policy and in government, but I'm just saddened that it's linked to Florence Nightingale, yeah, given her history and stuff. So we're trying to do some things, and probably next year we'll work with Croaky to do a bit of an article about it. I've talked to the ANF about it as well, ANMF, about, you know, just telling that story so people understand where we're coming from. Great. And they're not just saying we're being difficult, or it's actually got history and pain in that. So,
And tell me, with truth telling as well, you talked in your presentation today, your keynote, about that you're incorporating that telling stories.
Yes,
publicly. What's that about, and what are you hoping to tell?
I think just some of that true history. So I don't know, since I've been on Ngunnawal country in Canberra, I suddenly discovered the other day that Lake Burley Griffin is artificial and was a dam that flooded areas that were had sacred cultural significance and were traditional ceremony sites. So I had to then tweet that out because I was a bit disturbed by it. And now when I drive past the lake, it just bothers me. So I have to talk to the elders about that. I think we need to look at where we're living, what actually went on there, what the true story was, and lots of the elders know these stories, and start sharing that with people. So wherever I can, I try and bring a story out, you know, about that place. Like, and obviously coming here to Hobart, I realised this morning with quite, you know, with being alarmed, that there's no traditional owners left here. And like now there's the Palawa, which is all of Tasmania. But I feel really saddened by that. And I don't know how many people know that story, you know. So I think it's all those things. Where you go, what have we done to the people there, and what impact have we left? And we're all accountable for that. And I think it's not about blaming anyone or making anyone held to account, but acknowledging as a broader group at a conference or wherever that we did this to people and we did trauma through that, and we need to own that, and then we can move on from that, you know. So, yeah, I just try and go and dig out stories or ask questions, and because there's not a lot of that. And this morning I talked about East Perth and how that was an exclusion zone under that 1905 Act, and people couldn't go there without a permit. You know, they couldn't walk on their own country without permission from a white government body, and how much pain that leaves. And that's not ancient history. That ended in the 50s. You know, that's now. Those people are still alive and still tell those stories. So there's the history you learn in school, which is all Captain Cook and how great it was and, you know, the settlers and the convicts and all that. And then there's the real history, which is all the massacres and the genocides and the policies that discriminated. And so to me, it's contrasting the two. And, you know, neither is right or wrong, but it's a version of someone's story, and we can look at it whatever way. And I think it's not disrespecting anyone. We're just questioning what the truth was, and we're telling the truth. So that's a good thing. You know, NAIDOC theme this year, let's do it.
Fantastic. Now, is there anything else that you'd like to say?
I just want to say to everyone, CATSINaM's having their conference in Sydney in September from the 24th to the 26th. If you can get along, would be great to see you. If not, we're going to Cairns next year. So, you know, save up and you can come along. And also just, you know, reach out to us if you need any advice or you want to know more or you just want to make your service more culturally safe or retain your workforce that's Indigenous. Come and talk to us. You know, advice is free and we're happy to do it as long as you're genuinely committed and you're coming with an open heart and you want to learn how to be better. then that's fine. But if you've already made up your mind, yeah, don't knock on my door. Thanks.
So, thank you so much for your time.
No worries.